Members, business debate on motion 131 in the name of Rachael Hamilton on success of Great Borders River Clean. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Could I invite members who want to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? And I call on Rachael Hamilton to open the debate. Ms Hamilton, way up in the gods, you have around 7 minutes, Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I firstly want to start by thanking members for attending my members' business debate today on the first day back after recess. And so it's good to see you all again. Haggard or revitalised, we return. So old tyres, baby wipes, bottles, bicycles, a plastic picnic chair and baler twine are just a few items that my family and I picked up along the River Tweed on the Great Borders River Clean. And it's a tremendous initiative in its own right, but undoubtedly a blatant excuse for us to debate today the importance of our wonderful Scottish rivers and address the biodiversity loss, habitat degradation, species extinction, extreme flooding, and the fight to reverse the decline in wild salmon stocks, which is very pertinent in my constituency. With delight in my motion, I also cover Volunteers Week, which is an annual event which really showcases the best of giving back to the communities in which we live. Where would we be without people who give up their time? The Volunteers Week campaign started in 1984, which means that 2021 was the 37th year of formally saying thank you to volunteers. So turning to the main event, which you've all been waiting for, the Great Borders River Clean is a wonderful project which organises regular, large-scale river clean-ups throughout the Scottish borders. Residents from towns and villages across my constituency and along the rivers and streams across the borders take part in the River Clean, predominantly those surrounding the wonderful River Tweed. And all of the rubbish collected is then transported to the local waste transfer station and recycled. And I want to put on record my special and heartfelt thanks to Tom Rawson of St Mary's School in Melrose, who's actually in Christine Graham's constituency, and I'm glad to see that she's joined the debate this evening. Thank you, Christine. And Tom founded Green Tweed Echo, who organised this fantastic project, and the work of his environmental organisation aims to link environmental groups and charities with young people and schools across Scotland. And through the development of large-scale wildlife conservation and education projects, they encourage engagement between Scotland's children and the natural world around us. As we hand over our planet to the younger generation, it's vital that they have the awareness and understanding of caring for our environment. And I must also give mention to Tom's school, St Mary's, which was the first primary school in Scotland to successfully eliminate single-use plastics. And furthermore, the town of Melrose itself is making really good progress to reduce plastic consumption by becoming one of Scotland's first towns to be accredited as a plastic-free community by the Marine Conservation Group charity Surface Against Sewage. Presiding Officer, I'd now like to turn, if I may, to why the River Clean is so important and what it means for river pollution. We are aware of the damage that plastic pollution causes to river flora and fauna, and a widespread Greenpeace survey of 13 UK rivers has found that they all contain plastic pollution. In the first nationwide exercise of its kind, scientists actually found that microplastics were in 28 of the 30 locations tested. And we can't forget also that around 80% of marine microplastics come from freshwater runoff, meaning that there is a whole period where microplastics persist in rivers before they are actually flushed into the ocean. It's important we have cleaner rivers for the sake of our wildlife and the wildlife that make it their home. It is their home. And a lot of this is man-made, and it's up to us to actually do something about it. So over the years, we've seen the success of Scottish fishing take a real knock. The decline in salmon stocks, which I've spoken about in the chamber here before, is affecting Scottish rivers across Scotland. And the dire consequences many areas are now facing can partially be attributed to pollution itself. According to salmon and trout conservation, the problem begins upstream in our rivers, where there's a shocking 50% of aquatic insects that now contain microplastics. Whilst we can acknowledge that there's no one single cause for the decline in salmon stocks, the plastic pollution and human activity are a major contribution. And it might be of interest to members that the 10 years from now, from 2021 until 2030, have been designated by the United Nations as a decade on ecosystem restoration. Riverbank ecosystems are part of our life support system, and I want to see the Scottish Government provide more support for riparian woodland. And I can't see up here, but I think that's Minister Mary McCallan down there. I'd like her to take on board some of these asks. We want to see shaded tributaries with cool pools where salmon thrive, and we can begin to tackle the falling number of salmon stocks, a policy supported by Scottish Woodland. And I am actually the riparian woodland champion, would you believe? So I'd now like to point out some of the other actions that I believe would be beneficial. I think that the Scottish Government should actually look to incentivise widespread uptake of well-planned riparian woodland creation throughout schemes such as the forestry grant schemes, which are actually already being rolled out just now, but we could actually extend them to include riparian woodland species. Nature network corridors, they're another really fantastic way of rolling out riparian habitat aspirations, particularly in all local authority areas right across Scotland. And the regional use land partnerships could also be used to help deliver riparian networks at scale across Scotland. However, the most important thing that the Scottish Government can do is to give clarity to farmers on their future farm policy, because with support, land managers who are keen to be part of the climate change solution could improve the riparian zones along the tributaries and the rivers and the brooks and all the other bits that they have that they are able to along the river bank itself. So as we leave here tonight, possibly stopping for a wild swim on the way, Jackson Carlow told me he was going to be doing that, I want us to reflect that positive change is possible, and we mustn't sit back and allow pollution to damage our rivers. Every one of us must act, and we must act now. I would encourage all members, because it's very satisfying picking up rubbish, especially dragging big tyres across very wide and long fields. And it's good, you know, it's good. It's good for everyone. And if kids can do it and families can do it, we can all get involved. But it's for our constituencies, it's for our country, and we can feel proud of our communities by giving back. And whether it's a river clean or a beach clean, getting together with these groups to help tackle the blight of litter and pollution is absolutely essential. And we need to be more like Tom Rawson. So whilst these cleanups only form a small part of the wider role we'll play in tackling climate change and reducing the impact that humans have on our planet, they are nonetheless vital and really bring communities together and making our rivers safer for wildlife. And I just want to thank once again all the volunteers, Tom Rawson, and everybody who's been involved in the great river cleanup. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Hamilton. I think Mr. Carlow almost had a coronary at the prospect of wild swimming. I now call Emma Harper, who will be followed by Finlay Carson. Emma Harper, you have 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate this evening, and I congratulate Rachael Hamilton on securing it. And she's already highlighted so much good work in her opening remarks. I too want to start by congratulating Green Tweed Eco on bringing together this year's Great Borders River Clean, which took place between the 15th and the 16th of May, and which was supported by the Fallagio Environment Fund. This important work led the 460 volunteers that took the time to clean up the River Tweed, and I want to congratulate the River Tweed Forum for their important role in helping to educate on the importance of the river in terms of biodiversity and in the river's role in tackling the climate emergency. The work of the volunteers led to over 3,000 kilograms of rubbish being removed from the Tweed, particularly remarkable considering that most of the heavy items, like some of the car tyres and scrap metal, etc., are still under several feet of water. The amount of waste recorded was a real testament to the determination of all involved to remove as much rubbish as possible from the riverbanks. And interest in fines have included, and Rachael Hamilton has mentioned some of them already, there's been major car parts, intact fishing rod, broken kayak, as well as the usual detritus of our modern lives, bottles, plastic toys, clothing, and hundreds of thousands of wet wipes. This River Clean demonstrates what communities can achieve when they come together for a good cause, and I again congratulate everyone involved. Presiding Officer, across Dumfries and Galloway, in the west of my South Scotland region, there is a lot of work going on by hard-working volunteers also to clean our rivers and coasts. One example is the Galloway Fisheries Trust, who are working to ensure clean riparian riverbanks, habitats and management. Riparian management has already been mentioned by Rachael Hamilton in her opening remarks. Riparian management can have important benefits to the surrounding catchment. Watercourses can be damaged by excessive overgrazing by livestock, overshading by bankside trees, or the presence of alien plant species. The Galloway Fisheries Trust have completed various improvement works, including installing bankside fencing, organising controlled grazing agreements, extensive spraying of Japanese knotweed, giant hogweed, and skunk cabbage, as well as the removal of riparian coniferous forestry and planting deciduous trees in the riverbank zone. All of this work has led to a reduced acidity level in Galloway rivers, such as the River Bladnoch near Wigtown, the Water of Dee near Castle Douglas, and the Old Millburn near Newby, which is close to Annan. In addition to the important work of the Galloway Fisheries Trust, the Solway Firth Partnership have been working extremely hard through to tackle marine litter through organising beach and water cleans with volunteers throughout the region. Marine litter is human-created waste that has either been deliberately discarded, accidentally lost, or transported by winds and rivers into the sea and on the beaches. Marine litter is not just unsightly, but can be dangerous too. It can cause harm to public health and injury to our marine and coastal wildlife, our birds and other sea life. The D&G Eco Warriors, they're a worthwhile mention. They've been working to address issues of coastal littering, and I was pleased to have joined them in 2019 and hope to do so again. We found a few nurdles on the beach near Kirkcudbright. The Solway Firth Partnership and D&G Eco Warriors are particularly concerned over the impact of fly-tipped waste, and that's an issue that I have previously highlighted, and I'd like to therefore ask the Minister in closing what action the Scottish Government is taking to assist local authorities in education and reinforcement or enforcement of fly-tipping offences, especially in coastal areas when it can present a real threat. Just once again, the River Tweed is described by our own MSP, Alistair Allen, in his book, The Tweed Rins to the Sea. I'm sure that the Borders River Clean has helped greatly to maintain its appeal for walkers and visitors to enjoy. And I have to remind everybody that all the money raised by Alistair Allen's book is going to charity. So thank you again, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. I now call Finlay Carson, who will be followed by Colin Smith. Mr Carson, you have 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank my colleague Rachael Hamilton for bringing this important and first members' debate of the new session. Waste, primarily plastic, has become a serious problem for the environment, especially in our rivers, seas and oceans. You only need to go for a short stroll along most Scottish beaches to discover just how serious the issue has become. Fortunately, in my own constituency of Galloway and West Dumfries, there is a growing number of volunteers consisting of primary school pupils, young people and even the not-so-young, who are all equally determined to tackle not only the menace of plastic, but general rubbish left strewn in the sand and around our rivers. 3 years ago, three youngsters, Lottie, Fiona and Lucy, formed the Dumfries and Galloway Eco Warriors, and what a shining example it has become. And within a matter of months, it attracted 750 members, and that figure has doubled in recent times. Through organised beach cleans across the Solway coast, they have shifted tons of plastic as well as rubbish, ranging from golf clubs to car wheels that have been left behind. Although their activities have somewhat been curtailed because of the pandemic, these eco-warriors are ready to go into battle once more to clean up the beautiful beaches and coves scattered along the Solway coastline and beyond. Their slogan, "Together we can make a difference," probably says it all, and I would urge other members of the public to join in and show their support. Another local clean-up organisation, this time in Wigtonshire, Ocean Needs Us South West Scotland, have staged similar clean-up exercises again around the harbour in Stranraer, and it shows just how much people care and want to take pride in their community. Interestingly, there's a number of plastic collection prototype projects beginning to be developed that could help us reduce litter problems in rivers and seas. And the Solway Firth Partnership is looking to tackle this in a holistic way in the southwest corner of Scotland. Together with Marine Scotland and others, the partnership aspires not only to provide clean coasts but prevent plastic and litter coming downstream into the estuary. So it's important to get the support and resources and help to achieve this goal. Given that tackling climate change and improving and protecting the environment is not a short-term challenge, I call on the government to ensure that funding packages reflect the need for long-term solutions. And as I mentioned earlier, there are projects afloat, including one being trialled in Holland, appropriately named Catchy, that might be successful in improving our water quality. Comprising of two floating booms, a floating frame and a collection cage, the All Seas Projects works on wind and current movement, and it can be floated either in the quayside or even in the middle of a harbour to collect floating litter. So thankfully there are new technologies and solutions being developed, but I believe we can't and we shouldn't rely on technology to do the dirty work for us. We need a culture change. We need to make littering and fly tipping as socially unacceptable as drink driving or smoking in public places, and encourage people to do the right thing. And I welcome my colleague Murdo Fraser's plans to bring forward a fly tipping bill. But we need to take personal responsibility and take our litter home and not rely on others to clear up the mess after us. So maybe further rollout and funding for countryside rangers can help educate people. But until then, we have to seriously thank all our eco-warriors for all their sterling work in the past and in the future.
Thank you very much, Mr Carson. I now call on Colin Smith, who will be followed by Christine Graham. Colin Smith, you have 4 minutes to.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Rachael Hamilton for tabling her motion. Presiding Officer, this debate gives Parliament the opportunity to really pay tribute to all those who give up their time to organise and volunteer in riverbank litter picks, such as the Great Borders River Clean. And great, I have to say, is certainly a fitting description. The inaugural clean-up in October 2019 attracted 304 rubbish collectors who between them bagged an incredible 1.85 tonnes of rubbish. That grew to over 450 volunteers collecting more than 2 tonnes during the second clean-up on a chilly February-March weekend last year. And despite the huge challenges and restrictions all our local communities have faced in recent months, it was good to see the clean-up return in May this year when an amazing 460 volunteers collected 3 tonnes of rubbish from the Tweed. So I want to echo the thanks that we've heard already for the work of Tom Rawson, the award-winning Green Tweed Eco, with the support of the Faligo Environment Fund, who have made these clean-ups possible and ensured that borderers can enjoy far cleaner river banks as a result. But, Presiding Officer, the Great Borders River clean-up is about more than just ensuring our river banks are that bit more litter-free. It's also about pride in our towns and the villages in the borders and right across the south of Scotland. And with 6 tonnes of rubbish removed during just 3 events, the clean-up really does also raise awareness of the scale of the problem of primarily plastic pollution that plagues far too many of the riversides in our communities. We've all seen the appalling images of beaches and Bali covered in rubbish, birds in the Atlantic feeding plastic to their chicks. But the damage caused by plastic pollution is happening in the rivers and the burns that run into them right here on our own doorsteps. And we are ultimately the cause of that pollution, and it's our problem to solve it. That means we need tough action on those who leave litter on our landscape, a problem that sadly does appear to be on the rise. It means properly enforcing action to reduce the level of waste washed into waterways from nearby agricultural land whenever we are hit by heavy rainfall. But it also means tackling the level of what are often legal sewage spills into rivers and seas, a level that has risen by 40% over the last 5 years. Scottish Water's own figures show that the equivalent of 47,000 Olympic-sized swimming pools worth of waste has been discharged into our rivers and seas since 2016. The legal practice of releasing storm water and waste through sewage overflows into our seas and rivers that would normally go to water treatment centres but can't because of their capacity is on the increase. It seems it's no longer emergency release, but all too often routine release. That's raw sewage legally being poured into our waterways, everything from plastic toothpicks to wet wipes, the very items that we all see when we're carrying out those litter picks on our riversides or on our beaches. There are many high-profile incidents of this, not least just north of the borders on the Esk and Midlothian, where local residents are rightly concerned at the level of pollution, partly as a result of discharge from overflows from the sewage system. Now, I get the fact that this action is taken to stop sewage back up into homes, into businesses, into streets, open spaces, particularly at times of heavy rain. Of course, we need to better get the message across that people should not be disposing of items such as wipes into the sewage system in the first place. But I think it also shows that we do need to look again at the level of investment being made in the capacity we have in that system, because it's quite clear to me that is increasingly failing to cope. Ultimately, though, Presiding Officer, it's also yet another wake-up call when it comes to climate change, a symptom of the increase in rainfall levels and more intense storms that we are facing. And unless we tackle that climate crisis and the level of surface water we have to manage, the scale of flooding, of pollution that we need to contend with, the amount of litter that has to be cleaned from our beaches and rivers will simply grow and grow. Presiding Officer, communities in the borders are stepping up to the mark when it comes to cleaning up their environment. And in the important months ahead, we as policymakers need to match their commitment when it comes to the action we take to protect our precious environment for them and all our communities. In the meantime, however, I want to thank each and every one of the volunteers that give up their time to put the great into the Great Borders River clean-up. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Smith. I now call on Christine Graham, who will be followed by Martin Whitfield. Ms Graham, you have 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I too congratulate Rachael Hamilton, representing the neighbouring constituency to my own, on securing this debate. I represent, of course, the western side of the borders, Midlothian South, Tweedale and Lauderdale, accompanying from the Eildon Hills actually to the foothills of the Pentlands. So I'm very familiar with the route and significance of the River Tweed to the lives and the economy of the borders, as it has through the centuries, from when it undoubtedly was a major route for early humans, passing through to the time when it tended the great water wheels that drove the textile industry, and of course continuing to this day as a great salmon river, all 97 miles of it. Of course, it's not all about the Tweed, but its many and diverse tributaries, watercourses, which feed it on its path as it rises high up in Tweedsmuir, very humbly, through to England, to Berwick and to the sea, via, of course, Peebles, Innerlethen, Galashiels and Melrose. The waterways that feed into it, such as Eddleston Water, Turford Burn at Eddleston, Leithen Water at Innerlethen, Gala Water, obviously at Gala, to name but a few, are equally important in the cleaning process. But like others, I cannot, of course, speak on this issue without first recognising the pivotal role of Tom Rawson, teacher at St Mary's Primary in Melrose, an indefatigable environmental activist. He is engaged with riverside communities along these waterways, as well as the river itself, in the clean-up, and it's synchronised so that one day across the constituency, across the borders, communities are involved in their local clean-up, taking ownership of their own waterway. Indeed, as others have said, over 450 borders turned out to clean up the mess of the minority, a minority ignorant, uncaring about the damage to the environment and indeed to wildlife and the health of the river, that they are fortunate enough to have navigating past their community. 22 bags of litter were collected in the Turford Burn at Eddleston one Saturday. Eddleston is another example when clean-up extends also to ensuring natural debris is cleared. And indeed, the Eddleston Water Project has planted along its path vegetation and also diverted the river to make it snake the water to snake more, to slow its path, helping it to reduce the prospect of flooding downstream, especially at Tweed Green and Peebles, which has been all too common. Flood prevention, as we know, hardly needs to be said, starts upstream. Deputy Presiding Officer, those who despoil our waterways, whether it's plastic, debris or pesticide, should be held to account and prosecuted. They should be reported to SEPA or to the Council Environmental Department. No one should desist from reporting people doing this. It can be done discreetly. I applaud the majority and, of course, the volunteers and the biggest volunteer of all, Tom Ralston, the good guys, and thank them for protecting the Tweed and her varied waterways. We mortals are merely passing through, as generations of our predecessors have done before us. We are custodians of our environment. We should leave our rivers, the River Tweed, our waterways, better than we found them. Cleaner, clearer. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. I now call Martin Whitfield, who will be followed by Carol Mochen. Mr Whitfield, 4 minutes as well.
I'm very grateful, and can I just extend my congratulations to you, which I haven't managed to do as Deputy Presiding Officer for some while. And it's a great pleasure to follow the speech of Christine Graham, who is right, firstly, obviously, to thank all of the volunteers, but also to hold to account those individuals who recklessly tip and dump in the rivers. And if they didn't do that, our volunteers wouldn't need to do so much work. And I'd also like to congratulate Rachael Hamilton on this member's debate this evening. And it is a great pleasure to come together in this chamber to thank people who genuinely do work, not seeking publicity, not even really seeking thanks, just seeking the enjoyment of being together and doing good for their communities. And obviously the Great Borders River Clean is a fine example of that, funded by the Falgo Environment Fund, which, when it was set up, was done so to enhance the quality of life for local communities and visitors to the borders through investment in protection, enhancement and appreciation of the natural, the built and the cultural heritage of the Scottish borders environment. And it is a great credit to both EDF Renewables and Roxburgh Estate that they required these to be encompassed within the thoughts behind the funding that they provide. And that brings us, of course, to the Great Borders Cleanup itself. If we look slightly wider at, indeed, River Cleanup, which is a worldwide group of river warriors, they estimate some 8 billion kilograms of waste end up in our seas and oceans, having transported down our rivers, the very arteries of our society. And to think of that 8 billion, 2,000 kilograms were removed by the Great Borders volunteers, by those 453 people who gave up their time. And to give you some idea of the volume of that, it would take approximately 50 small plastic disposable bottles to make up a kilogram. And you think about the large articles that were dragged across farmers' fields. You think about the bags that were collected to go to landfill. And think how much easier it would have been for the individuals to put them in the bin themselves rather than expect others to gather them together. But here we are, and between May and June last year, 750 teams around the world worked on cleaning up their rivers because they recognised the importance of their rivers to their community, to communication, to the wildlife, and to the future that they want to leave their children. And those arteries make their way to the sea, which brings me to mention Surfers Against Sewage, who I have mentioned in other places, and the phenomenal work that they do on beaches with regard to the cleanup. And not just organising cleanups, but organising surveys. And in August, the 11th of August indeed, the brand audit report came out from the surfers. And it highlighted, after a million miles of beach clean, exactly where this rubbish comes from. And they identified the Dirty Dozen, the 12 companies around the world that are responsible for almost three quarters of all the plastic and packaging pollution that ends up going into the sea and then twice in 24 hours with the tides gets washed back ashore. We have 13 beaches in south of Scotland that recognised with the Scotland's Beach Awards, communities that have looked after their beaches to meet the criteria of access, facility, safety, local environmental quality, community and heritage. And I take this moment just to remind people that between the 17th and 26th of September, you can attend your local beach for the beach cleanup here in Scotland. And I would urge you to do so because I know that the volunteers will be there. Time is short, but I just want to mention one idea which I hope the Minister can consider. I realise it's not within her gift, but maybe to promote. And that is something that's been organised by the Scottish Borders Council, by the People's Project in Dumfries and Galloway, and indeed by the East Lothian Countryside Volunteers. And that is a library of litter collection equipment, plastic bags, gloves and litter pickers, so that our volunteers can go out and do their best. The Destiny Project in Preston Pan spent last weekend clearing up fly tipping from visitors who decided to set up camp in one of our fields. And off their own bat, and again, not because of publicity, just because it was the right thing to do, they went and collected up that rubbish. And so, in conclusion, I want to reflect many of the speeches which rightly say thank you to the volunteers, because they are taking care of their community in a way that is special and individual to them. And it's about time all of us thought, what does that happen if you just drop that plastic bottle? Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whitfield. I now call on Carol Mochen, who will be the final speaker in this open debate. Ms Mochen, you have 4 minutes as well.
Lovely. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also start by thanking all the volunteers in the Borders who participated in the Great Border River clean-up this year and in previous years, and also to the member, Rachael Hamilton, for securing a member's debate on this issue. It is important that actions from local communities are spoken about and acknowledged here in the Scottish Parliament. Over 400 people from a number of villages across the Scottish Borders all working together to not only demonstrate the strength of spirit of towns and villages pulling together to tackle a common cause, but also show where we need to act to treat the natural environment which we rely on and must take responsibility for. In many parts of the south of Scotland, as people have said, communities are quite rightly concerned about the environment, about littering and fly tipping. Many communities take in excellent direct action events, such as the River Clean, litter picks and beach clear-ups mentioned by Martin. The benefits of cleaning green space, our rivers and our fields undoubtedly has many advantages, from the aesthetics, attracting tourists to the beautiful towns and villages across the borders and beyond, to environmental benefits, education, teaching people from an early age to respect the environment and understand the damage of plastics and overconsumption of goods, which undoubtedly previous generations have succumbed to. The Great Borders River clean-up, as it aimed to do, has brought into sharp focus the scale of the problem and that we are facing 3,000 kilograms of rubbish pulled from a Borders river in one weekend. What a throwaway society we live in. This shocking figure, the organisers hope, will raise awareness of the effects of this issue and may help change behaviours and reduce the amount of litter entering the natural environment. This is very much needed, and young people across the planet are telling us to act now. They are instructing us to take this issue seriously. We must, as a parliament, accept our responsibilities. We must do more and take responsibility to ensure legislation and funding to prevent the causes of such environmental problems. We must be serious about a Zero Waste Scotland. We need to use the evidence we have to move on education, to seek local authorities to respond to the reasons identified, whether it be socio-economic problems or barriers to accessing services or education around changes in behaviour. I would like to end by saying just how important this subject is, and I hope we will return to the Chamber many times to demonstrate we take this subject very seriously. This would be the best thank you we could offer the volunteers. Before I close, I once again commend the Great Borders River clean-up and thank all the volunteers. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mochen. I now invite Mary McCallum to respond to the debate. Minister, you have around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And congratulations to Rachael Hamilton for securing this important member's motion. I'd also like to thank everyone that stayed tonight to contribute, and I welcome their views. Just on the theme of thank yous, I'd like to begin my response on behalf of the Scottish Government by once again offering our sincere thanks to two groups of people. Firstly, to Scotland's incredible waste and resources key workers, who during an anxious and difficult time have worked tirelessly to keep our vital systems operating. While those of us who were able to could work from home, they went out, they kept our environment clean, and I want to thank them and all of Scotland's key workers for that. And I'd also like to extend this government's thanks to our communities and volunteers who also rallied to the enormous challenges of the pandemic, keeping communities together as we had to stay apart, and to everyone who dedicate themselves to causes like keeping our natural environment enjoyable for all. Volunteer Week always shines a spotlight on the efforts of volunteers, including those in the Great Borders River Clean. But there are countless groups across the country who faithfully clear up our beautiful countryside. I was really pleased to join a litter pick in Rigside in my own Clydesdale constituency last week. And I want to take the opportunity to thank those volunteers as well. They work tirelessly for our people and for our planet. Despite my thanks, it's clear that cleaning up our waterways should not fall to volunteers. There's been so many varied points made tonight, and I would love to pick up on them all, but in my closing remarks, I want to focus on something that I think progress needs to be made on, and that is the Scottish Government's plans for litter and fly tipping, just as Emma Harper asked me to outline. Before I do that, I just want to pick up on a couple of points that have been made throughout. Rachael Hamilton mentioned riparian tree planting and other forms of support. I had the privilege of visiting a natural tree regeneration project in the Cairngorms over the summer and saw firsthand how the river began to adapt to the natural regeneration of woodland around it and how life returned, and it was a wonderful thing to see. She also mentioned future farming policy. I'm very pleased to see my colleague Marie Goujon, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, announce the Future Farming Implementation Board as part of the government's 100 days. It will drive forward the future farming policy, and I know firsthand just how ready Scotland's farmers are to contribute to supporting biodiversity, tackling climate change, all while continuing to produce sustainable, healthy food. Colin Smith rightly picks up on the point about sewage outflows. I agree with much of what he said. I think there's two points to stress. Firstly, that, as I think he set out, this is a really vital mechanism to ensure that it doesn't back up into homes and businesses when there is adverse weather. But he also pointed out that that is recurring. Now, it's important for us all to accept that as the impact of climate change begins to be felt, extreme weather conditions are going to become more, we're going to have to become more accustomed to them. And I agree that just as we all must adapt to climate change, the Scottish Government must be ready to as well. So I've asked my officials to work with Scottish Water and SEPA, who are already investing heavily in this, just to make sure that we're keeping up to date with the climate emergency and the implications of it. And Martin Whitfield, the litter picking library, I like this idea. A little girl in my own life, when asked at the beginning of this summer holidays what she was going to be doing, she told me, "Well, I've ordered a litter picking kit from South Lanarkshire Council." So I thought, my gosh, how times have changed. But, you know, young people are so alive to these issues, and I like the idea. But just to return to one of the points that I want to stress tonight, fly tipping, littering, it's illegal, it's dangerous, it's unnecessary, and there's no excuse for it anywhere in Scotland. Our environment is blighted by it. Valuable resources, which could form part of our circular economy if recycled, they're wasted. And taxpayers and landowners, they bear the brunt of the cleanup. Now, I'm acutely aware that fly tipping is not something that has happened just because of the pandemic. It was a problem before. But there's no doubt that it created new challenges. And actually, as people spent more time in their homes and their own communities, the problem was noticed more. A whole lot of hard work went into helping our waste and resources industry to minimise disruption during lockdowns, and again, I just want to praise those workers who kept everything flowing, as it were. There is evidence that the incidence of fly tipping and littering has decreased as waste services, just like everything else in life, began to creep back to something more like normality. But despite that, the government is preparing to renew our commitment to tackling the problem with a new approach and accelerated action to address it. We know that the current policy and political landscape is very different from when our national littering strategy was first published. We're now facing the climate emergency, we're out of the EU against our wishes, and we're navigating a global pandemic. So ahead of COP26 in Glasgow this year, we've been working on developing a new litter and fly tipping strategy, which will recognise that these are different issues which both require prominence and a tailored approach. The Scottish Government has committed to publish this refreshed and updated strategy in early 2022. I will publish a consultation later in the year to outline the key actions in the new strategy, including it looking at where legislation may need to be renewed or updated. It will be developed in close collaboration with our key stakeholders, including SEPA, Zero Waste Scotland, Keep Scotland Beautiful, and of course local authorities, who are responsible for and best placed to make decisions on waste prioritisation. And as somebody who... Yes, of course.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to give way, and it's welcome to see new thinking and rethinking indeed regarding tipping. Does the policy recognise that there are a sort of fundamental separation in those that fly tip, the commercial businesses that fly tip, in essence for profit for themselves, as well as people, individuals who fly tip for want of access or some other, may I say, lame excuse as to not being able to take things to the tip? Will the policy reflect the differences in those that do tip?
Sorry, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to the member for that really important point, and I think that that nuance is something that I'm very determined is going to be part of this consultation, because to address the issue, we have to understand its causes. And I was just going to point out that as someone who lives in a rural location and has personal experience and frustrations of littering and fly tipping being done in and around my home, you know, I'm determined that this consultation and this exercise will reflect lived experience. Yes, of course.
Christine Graham.
I noted in the stakeholders that you mentioned, Minister, you didn't mention police. And I know in my many years here, police and SEPA worked together when we had commercial operators dumping poisonous waste, undercutting reasonable and conventional environmental disposal people and getting undercutting them in price and dumping it wherever they liked. So could it be possible to include the police in the stakeholders that you mentioned?
Minister.
Thank you, and I thank the member for the point. Yeah, Christine Graham, absolutely, I agree with you that this is littering and fly tipping is a criminal offence, and the police should absolutely be involved in the development of the policy. I'm conscious that I'm running short of time, but in summary, I want to stress that we recognise and we celebrate the value of kindness, which is inherent in volunteering. We want to ensure that everybody who wants to volunteer can, but I also trust that I've made it clear that this government is determined to tackle the causes of litter and fly tipping and environmental damage, and to focus on prevention so that it doesn't fall to our volunteers to deal with the consequences. And in doing that, we can clean up our beautiful natural environment, deliver a truly circular economy and all the economic benefits that come with that, and we can together build a just and fair transition to net zero. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes this debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.